now back to Just Energy Radio with Dr. Rita Louise.
Hello and welcome back to Just Energy Radio. I'm Dr. Rita Louise, your host today. And this hour, we're going to be speaking to Paul Von Ward about his new book, The Children of the Living Universe. But don't forget, Just Energy Radio is brought to you by soulhealer.com, where you can find out about all the products and services I offer, including medical intuition evaluations, energy medicine, and psychic readings. So if there's things going on in your life, drop me a note, send me an email. We can set up a time for a consultation over the phone, in person, and even by Skype. It's also brought to you by the Institute of Applied Energetics, where you can jumpstart your intuition today by downloading our free 50-page guide. That's www.appliedenergeticsinstitute.com. So let me tell you a little bit about Paul, and we're going to continue with this whole conversation about spirituality and who we are and where we come from in the universe. Interdisciplinary cosmologist and independent scholar, Paul Von Ward is internationally known for the hypothesis of an AB, advanced being, intervention in human development. His theory of natural spirituality in an evolving self-learning universe and research on survival of a personal soul genome. Paul's research on five continents keeps his provocative publications grounded in emerging science and credible human experience. So the author of Children of a Living Universe, his webpage is vonward.com, Paul Von Ward. Hi, Paul. How are you?
I'm just wonderfully fine tonight out here in the backwoods of North Georgia.
You're in Georgia? I thought you lived in Tennessee.
Well, I did, but I'm now here. It's not too far from where I used to be in the Appalachians over there in Tennessee, and now we're in the foothills of the Appalachians here in North Georgia. It's a wonderful place for research and writing because we're not we're not bothered by a lot of noise and a lot of energetics, but we're out here in nature and plenty of time for meditation and going inside to search for new ideas.
Well, wonderful. So, Paul, you call yourself a cosmologist. What is that, and how did you become interested in cosmology?
Well, first, I'd like to just say that most people have a mistaken idea about the term cosmologist. Most of the people who call themselves cosmologists in the world today are physicists. There may be mathematicians or some other areas of science, but most of the people who talk about themselves as a cosmologist are people who are dealing with the standard model of science, very narrow, very physically based, but the original meaning for cosmology was the whole picture of the universe, the cosmos, and the first cosmologists looked at the world around them in a natural way. Many of the ancient traditions had all kinds of theories and concepts that we have let fall by the wayside over the centuries. And so I use the term now interdisciplinary cosmologist because I think we need to take the research and the concepts from all of the disciplines, not only physical science, but also metaphysical, physiological, speculative thinking about the answers that we are searching for about the reality of our universe. So that's what I'm trying to communicate to my readers and people that are listening to us, that we're looking at the big picture. We're looking at it from all forms and perspectives of knowledge and human experience.
Well, and I think that you know, it's an important role to take, because I believe you're right. I mean, I think it's important that there are a lot of individuals who like to work out the details, you know, and they will find a specific problem and look to address that issue, you know, because it makes, you know, work like you're doing or the work that I do easier, because, you know, people have worked out the details and you can take these puzzle pieces and start putting them into the bigger puzzle, you know, into kind of that more umbrella. How does this all fit together? Don't
exactly.
you think?
We're on the same tune right there at this point, because I think that what has happened in the last 1,000, 2,000 or more years, that we've narrowed our views depending on the culture and the worldviews that we have grown up with. So religions and all of their varieties have very narrow concepts, belief systems about what the universe is all about. And the same thing happened with science coming out of the Middle Ages. Some of the first scientists in the 15th century and the 16th century, all those great men of, you know, Galileo and Newton and Bruno and others, they were people somewhat like me, or I am like them. They were looking at the whole universe. But what happened is that science sort of splintered into these academic disciplines. And so what we have then at this point is we have a whole cauldron of people yelling about what is real, but they're very narrow in their views. And this is true in religions and philosophy and in science. And what you and I are talking about is to let's put the puzzle pieces back together in a bigger picture.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting the way that you phrase that. It made me think of the government, where they have everything compartmentalized so that this group doesn't know what this group is doing, which doesn't know what that group is doing. I mean, I feel like, you know, even with the founding fathers, you know, you hear stories of Ben Franklin and some of the, you know, originators of the United States. You know, they were very worldly men that had a lot of skills and knew about a lot of different things, where, you know, that was only a couple of hundred years ago. So I don't know where it went away, you know, what caused it to go away, you know, unless it was a control thing, you know.
Well, I think that there is a concept, you know, of divide and conquer. And I think that people who are in a position where they feel that they have to get more wealth, more power for their own satisfaction and not have much concern for the rest of us, they do that. I've spent about 20 years in military and government, and what you said is exactly right. And these departments and agencies and committees on the Hill in Washington, D.C., and the Congress, they each have their own pet area, and they try to milk it for whatever they can through the legislative and political processes in Washington. But that'll get us off on another.
Yeah, well, that's really going off on a tangent, so let's kind of bring it back.
Yeah, let's do it.
Okay. And I wrote this question down, and it's kind of long, so just bear with me here. In the last 100 years or so, so much information has come forward about the physical nature of our universe. Studies in the areas of quantum physics have started to reveal information that, in my opinion, was unavailable, that was available to our ancestors. In the end, where does this leave us? Are we more than a physical body, as philosophy and religion suggest? You know, who or what are we? Well, I know that's kind of a really open-ended question, but
yeah, well, that's a perfect one, though, because what I've tried to do in this book is to take both the philosophical and spiritual religious orientation and also the physical sciences perspectives that have created all of this material that we now have. But what we are lacking is the different actors in this game of trying to get control over the course of human history and evolution and how we're going to keep our cultures together and so on. We have not sat down and talked to each other. And so what I'm trying to do is to take specific parts of what we might call cosmology. Let's talk about the mind versus the brain. You know, the physical sciences and neuroscience is right much in that arena right now, trying to determine what we should believe about the mind and the brain. Neuroscience is taking us in the direction now that the conclusion is that consciousness comes from the physical neuronal networks in our brain. However, on the other side of this question, we know in our spiritual and other practices, our own daily practices, know that thoughts come to us that we have not had before, that we have communicated with other beings, visions or information coming into us that has never been a part of our brain. So that suggests that, you know, it's not a clear-cut conclusion that the consciousness that we deal with every moment of the day is the product of the conditioning of the brain's neural nets that get the stimulation that we get when we're in the physical world. But all of the thoughts, all of the behaviors that we have in our brain, think about, you know, the dreams we have, the visions that we have, the voices that many of us have coming into our conscious awareness from other beings or other locations. All of these activities that are going on in our minds have not in any way been the product of some of these cells getting together and creating a thought. What we have to begin to think about is that how do we explain this interaction between the mind and the brain? And that then brings us to, if we want to extrapolate a little bit from our own, you know, experiences as individuals, that there is a consciousness that transcends us as individuals and as a species. And I think there's a lot of evidence for the consciousness model of the universe. And that's why I've tried to articulate this idea that the universe is really, at its own fundamental level, pure consciousness. And it's very interesting that we have now some physicists beginning to realize that the physical model that we have is incomplete and it doesn't answer these kinds of questions.
I mean, if that was the reality of where consciousness came from, then someone who has had parts of their brains removed, you would think would be less conscious or unconscious. I mean, they might have brain damage, but you would think that, you know, it would change their ability to, you know, have self-awareness, but it doesn't.
No, the whole concept of self-awareness is one of these conundrums, you know, that humans have dealt with for probably millennia. How is it that I am aware of myself being aware of trying to get a larger sense of awareness of the reality around me? I mean, you know, we have this to and fro kind of talking to ourselves, not just as individuals, but our whole communities, our whole species. And, you know, on this point of species, we know that we communicate with our pets, with other animals, with plants. We have so much evidence of the interactions among all of these species, and we can test out the impact of this interaction. I mean, one of the things I think about, Cleve Baxter, he's even much older than I am. He's been doing much work in the plants and human interaction field for 50 or more years. But his evidence and the evidence of many other people make it very obvious that plants communicate with us and we with them. The same thing with animals. I mean, anybody who lives in a world of pets and animals in the wild and in domesticated areas, you have this communication. Where does it come from? Where does the mind go when we have a near-death experience, when our body functions are totally out of operation, and yet our mind is looking down on what is happening to our body, and we are able to, after the fact, describe what happened? I mean, all of us know these things, the books that have been written over the last 10 years or so, I mean, we have just dozens of them with evidence for this separateness between consciousness and the physical brain. That's why I call it self-conscious, self-actualizing universe. And that means that we are the products of the fundamental, I don't want to use the word being or entity, because I think consciousness is much more than that. But all the communication that we have from these other dimensions are clearly not something generated by the human brain.
So are you talking about, like, you know, multidimensional extraterrestrials here? What are we talking about?
Well, I think I think extraterrestrial beings are in different dimensions. I think that many of our experiences as humans throughout history have involved physical beings like ourselves, that is, in the sense that they are physical, they have characteristics, abilities, and so on, very much like humans, but they may be more advanced. One of my books has been, you know, been focusing on these advanced beings. So these species are also conscious. We can communicate with them, and they are still in what I would call the third dimension or fourth dimension category. But I think beyond that, we have non-physical entities. And I've been, over the years, as I'm sure you've been interested to know, what are the messages that we get from channeled sources who say they are not physical entities, but they are very well aware of what we are, what we're doing, and they can talk about the cosmology that we're talking about from a position of non-physicality.
And I think what's your feeling about channeled material in general? I mean, I feel like it brings up a lot of red flags for me, and it brings up a lot of trust issues, because I know that some people can open themselves up and just be the vehicle. And then there are other people that, they're not that clear. And so their ego gets in the middle of the channel material. So that's one part of it. Yeah. But then there's the other part of who or what are you channeling? And should you trust that?
I think you've hit it on the nail there by characterizing the different kinds of material that comes through. We know that I like to use the hermetic principle that says, as above, so below. So let's talk about the human experience alone, and then let's have the same look at these other beings. In our own daily activities, we look at a particular event taking place, like an accident or some other exciting event that you're involved in. And then about a day later, you try to describe it, and it varies from person to person. We have our own interpretations and our own ideas, so we distort a little bit of the reality that we've experienced. And I think a lot of the channeling material is a product of that sort of behavior. In other words, we distort what we're hearing, what the entity on the other end has its own particular perspective on what he or she or it is trying to communicate with us. So I look at channeling like everything else. We have to be open to it. We have to take it as possible evidence, as possible descriptions of reality, but we want to test it, and so we don't accept it as the 100% truth, and we have to then have many sources with different information, and we have to then compare that material and that set of ideas, concepts that are given to us as humans. And then we have to put it all together and have our little community lessons that we are discussions with each other. In other words, if I have an insight from what I think is a non-physical entity has given me a concept, I would not say, hey, I've just got the truth on this issue or that one. And talk about this information. Let's not dismiss it. Let's not make fun of it. Let's not give it any sort of evaluation. But we want to put it on the table, and let's all talk about it and look at it from our own experiences. And out of that kind of exchange, we may have a much more precise interpretation of what our universe is really like. And what I've done in this book is I've spent years, thousands of discussions with people, looked at all sorts of evidence, and I put it together, not just as one singular product, but a synthesis of as many different views of reality as I could put together in one book.
So you've been talking about
plain. This is, I mean, I don't, you know, posit that this is the truth. Anyone who tries to say that, you know, you should sort of turn around and walk away. So I'm putting it out really for the stimulation of individual minds. Maybe there's some ideas, some concepts, some theories that I've put together that will stimulate a broader perspective on the questions that, you know, we don't have the answers to. Where do we come from? What are we doing here? Where are we going? How does this universe that we work, we don't have all those answers yet, but I think in this process we do make some little advancements each day as we are trying to better understand, you know, what our place is.
So you've been talking about humanity and our ability to have consciousness. What about the universe itself? You know, we live in the universe. We live on the planet Earth that's in the Milky Way, or, you know, that's part of this galaxy, and there are all of these other galaxies, and who knows what else is in the universe. Does the universe have consciousness it's also?
Yes. I try to sort of bring together all of these threads that we're talking about and many others in the chapters of the book. I try to put them together, and what it seems to me, and I'll talk a little bit in a moment about what the scientists are talking about it today, I think that the universe itself is consciousness. That is, there are several different levels of forces in the universe. You know, we talk about the physical forces and the energetic forces. Yes. Oh, okay. Is it not coming through very well? Is that better? Okay. Thank you very much. So what I'm trying to do is to look at what we were talking about a moment ago, the subtle energies, the telepathic abilities that we have, all of those kinds of outside the brain activities that we experience. And then if you look at that through the lens of many different species, you come to the conclusion that if all of this consciousness is connecting us, creating us, developing us, then the foundation, the source, is really pure consciousness. And I've been writing about that for quite a number of years now, and it's only in the last few months, really, although it's over the last couple of 3 years, we've had more physicists who are talking about the fundamental aspects of our universe. It's information rather than, you know, the physical and the energetic realms that we talk about, that beyond that, it's the information. The terms that are used are infobytes, infobits, the just word information is the fundamental foundation of the quantum realm that we now talk about as our universe. So what is information? What is infobits? It's really knowledge. And what is knowledge? Knowledge is consciousness, awareness. And so if that is the foundation, then the source of the universe, this universe, is the knowledge and awareness of itself, and that all of the galaxies, all of the physical systems that we have, and all of the energetic and the light systems that we have are the products of this conscious source or entity. And so that's where I think we're headed in terms of thinking about ourselves. We humans should think about ourselves as the one aspect of that source on our planet, in our solar system, in our galaxy, as the products through which the consciousness of the universe self-actualizes itself. In other words, if you want to put it in sort of personal terms, I would say that the universe is consciousness itself that is self-aware and is attempting to experience through all of its experiences, its all efforts at creating itself with its full potential. And that puts us humans and any other conscious, alive organism, as we evolve, as we learn, as we become more aware, more powerful in our use of our minds, this enlivens and enhances the evolution of the universe itself.
A good friend of mine, Dr. Amit Goswami, suggests that evolution on Earth occurred in a top-down model, that waves of increasing consciousness cause us to change and grow from single-cell life to where we are today. What do you think of that theory?
I think that's exactly what I think I'm trying to articulate, you know, with other terms, but I think it's the same thing. In other words, I'll really go out on a limb now, which is
we like limbs here.
Spiritual, a little bit of speculation, but I think that life on the planet is really a product of the seeds of information that were brought together on this planet through the physical processes that created our planet. And as its environment, as the physical environment changed over millennia, the information embedded on this planet evolved. That's the beginning of life. And what you're talking about, that evolutionary process has brought us continually upwards with a lot of missteps along the way. We're not doing very well on the planet at this point in time.
Let me interrupt you here for a second. Sure. So do you believe that we came from the primordial slime, or do you think that something else started the process of evolution on this planet?
Well, no, I wouldn't want to use the term primordial slime. I sort of would like
but
to
But you know
say,
what I'm talking about. You
know,
the amino acids that joint, or the chemicals that became amino acids that they can't figure out how it went from there.
Okay. Right, no, I think that's the way it happened. I also have an alternative on that, which is the panspermia theory, you know, that you had some already germs of life that had developed in some other planet or some other part of our galaxy, or even on our in our solar system. I mean, we now have water and moons and around other planets, and so there could be the seeds of life in other parts of our part of this galaxy that was already, these seeds were already activated. But I think the other one that you're talking about, we start with, because the physical and energetic particles that we deal with in physics were here on the planet, and when certain conditions arise in a part of a galaxy, it would seem to me that they are capable then of coming together to create that first cell. And the prokaryotes were the first, and then you went jump from that to the eukaryote, where we had a nucleus in there. So I'm not too concerned about which one of those stages came first someplace else or on this planet, but the whole evolutionary trajectory that we and all other life forms on this planet have experienced for, you know, all these millennia is the real central principle of the life and the life of the universe.
Okay, I'm looking at the clock and I'm going to look at my question list because what about the extraterrestrial question? They told me not to sit so close to the mic, so I'm backing up. So do you feel, you know, because we're talking about evolution and, you know, panspermia, but do you think that there has been alien intervention in the development of
absolutely.
Life on Earth?
We're talking tonight about the children of a living universe in terms of cosmology, but my book, We've Never Been Alone, is a very extensive look at the evidence for what I call intervention in human evolution by advanced beings. I like to use that term rather than aliens or extraterrestrials or whatever, because they may be from different dimensions or different galaxies or even just someplace else around our solar system. So wherever they came from, they were more advanced than humans were. And I have a whole trajectory developed there, I think, using the evidence of the fossil records that we have, the technology we now have to use projecting back into history for our genetic evolution, the patterns that we've gone through as humans. But it seems to me that there's just absolutely no way to explain the history of Homo sapien evolution without some external intervention. The first 5 million years of primates and so on, who have continued during that long, long period with very little changes on different species. But about 200,000 years ago, that big explosion that gave us Homo sapiens, and then 100,000 years later, we had Homo sapiens sapiens and all of the races that we have and the different aspects of the history that we can put together based on the fossil record and the stories of ancient civilizations, it's very clear that we could not be where we were 100 years ago without thousands of years of intervention by more advanced beings.
Why do you think it is so hard for researchers to wrap their mind around that? Or, I mean, because even, all right, and I'm just going to go out on a limb here, you know, even if you said God, you know, that, you know, like the biblical God was doing this intervention, you know, just to kind of save your butt, you know, to stay within the party. Well, I guess you can't say God because then it would be religion. I guess, you know, science has gotten themselves really in a bit of a conundrum. Maybe that's why we're so screwed up, because, you know, if you can't say God in a sentence, then what do you explain it on? I guess you just make stuff up. Sorry, well, talking out loud.
Well, when you talk about the word God, I see that it has two different connotations. God, if you use it in that sort of universal, omnipotent, omniscient entity, that could be nothing more than what I was calling the consciousness of the universe. But that word, or that use of God, is not what the religions are built on. They are built on the some of these ABs who came down out of the skies with a lot of advanced technology, taking advantage of more primitive humans for their own purposes. All of these things that we read about in the ancient astronauts, the gods of old, all of, I mean, I've written material and books in this area, and we're just filled with them right now. But what we are dealing with is we have to get up above the ET alien idea of an intervention and begin to see that as only a part of this intervention in human history by highly advanced minds of other species who were responsible for helping humans get downloads of science. I mean, we have evidence that advanced beings gave us alphabets, languages, architecture, astronomy, mathematics. Cultures have all kinds of records of that kind of intervention.
Oh, I agree with you 100%. And it's just sad that, you know, we are so brainwashed in the West, and I'm going to quantify that in the West, that, you know, we don't pay attention. I mean, you read texts that come out of, like, India, for example, and I'm just going to throw them out as just one culture. You know, when they talk about our multidimensional existence, and they talk about, in my opinion, you know, different vibratory planes and subtle energy, and it seems like physicists are just now discovering information that, you know, you could have went down to the metaphysical bookstore and got all the texts on it already.
Yeah. No, we have so much evidence around us from other cultures, and also we have much evidence in the Indo-European trajectory of civilization, what we call Western civilization, which is really based on the three Abrahamic religions, the Hebrew, Christian and Islam. And this is the problem, because all of three of these religions distorted this notion of these advanced beings, and they confused these intermediaries, these slightly more advanced than humans dealing with us, and they modeled the idea of God on those kinds of advanced beings, the aliens of ancient tales. And that's what got us off track for the last at least 2,000 years. And so we're now schizophrenic, and we can't deal with what I call natural science and natural philosophy, where you look at nature, you look at the reality, and develop a cosmology, which we're talking about tonight. Because when this supernatural concept of a god or gods and angels and so on divided from nature and it became supernatural, you can't talk about it, because the supernatural theology has to be interpreted by the leaders of these religions. And so that's what got us off track of studying natural science, like the pagans, the Celts, the Buddhists, the Taoists in China, and so on. They were left out of the Western model of reality. So what we're doing now is we're trying to pull together from science new concepts that are much broader than the standard model of physics. And we're also looking back again at the traditions all around the world who help us understand this intervention by advanced beings before we made them into gods. And we have to sort all of that out. And it's going to take us a while. I would say another few centuries. But I think we're making some progress, because I think what you're doing on your show, the books that we've been talking about, the researchers that we're talking about, we are gathering pieces of this bigger picture that I'm trying to articulate. And the more we get together and share our views and our differences, the faster we're going to get out of the current swamp, you know, of different religions, different aspects of science, the disciplines that don't talk to each other. And you have the same thing going on in science that you have in the fragmentation of religion. And so I hope that I've sort of explained a little bit the need for this idea of interdisciplinary cosmology and looking at the universe in a very different way, from starting with the little atoms and molecules. We need to start at the other end, that is, at the foundational level of the universe, and then try to figure out how the pieces fit into that universal interdisciplinary cosmology.
Yeah. You know, and it's a hard one in the general sense of the word. And just to let you know, we have 2 minutes, so I'm just going to make a comment and we're going to wrap up.
Okay.
You know, it's challenging, because to look at consciousness, you know, especially, you know, how things interact in the universe on a subtle energy level, I'll phrase it that way, mm-hmm. you have to have, like, you know, really open up your mind to be able to perceive all of these different aspects that can be challenging at best.
It is. And I find myself, as you heard tonight, I try to just personally open up my mind and then try not to pin things down too definitive answer. You know, I try to stay away from that because I want us to be open and consider these other options.
Anyway, Paul, if someone wants to get a copy of Children of the Living Universe or one of your other books, where's the best place for them to go?
Well, you know, it's already in Amazon, .com, Barnes & Noble, and I think it's getting into local bookstores by now. And so it's just very easy. And you can, if you want to go to my website, www.vonward.com, down at the home page, you can click on icon there for the book and get it right there. So,
perfect. Well, Paul, our time is up. The music is going to come up in a second. Thank you so much for coming on the show and sharing your insights with the listeners. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so very much.
Been a pleasure. All right. You're welcome. Thank you. That's Paul Von Ward. His book is Children of a Living Universe. His webpage is vonward.com. Next week, we have Robert Morningstar coming on talking about UFOs, government cover-ups, and the soul. Interesting combination. And Richard Allen Miller coming on for the spring solstice. But we're going to be talking about alternative agriculture. And so until next week, I'm Dr. Rita Louise. This is Just Energy Radio. Be blessed.
Join host Dr. Rita Louise each week at this time for Just Energy Radio.